Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is Great is Thy Faithfulness. Oh.
It says Great is Thy Faithfulness.
I thought 7:33.
If you say so.
Okay. Great is Thy Faithfulness is 7:33 in the Cranberry Hymnal, or in the Blue Hymnal with one voice, 771. So if you have a blue hymnal at home, it's hymn number 771.
Great is Thy faithfulness, morning by
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you show perpetual loving kindness to us, your servants. Because we cannot rely on our own abilities, grant us your merciful judgment and train us to embody the generosity of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Are there children on the call this morning? If so, please unmute yourself and say hi.
Hi.
Hi. Hi, Owen.
Hi, Pastor.
Hi. Who else do we have?
Did you get it?
Yeah, I did on camera because she knew I was this.
Okay. Who else do we have? They're the Symphyses. I see them. They are young at heart. We have the Dietrichs, and let's see, Owen, I am so glad that you're here today. Did you have fun at Zoom Faith Formation this morning?
Yes.
Yeah, what did you like about it? Did you have a favorite
part?
Yeah, when you went and you got your favorite object. And your favorite object is a helicopter?
Well, it's just the Hesper, and I'm going to try to tell that I was playing with them while I was waiting.
Oh, okay. I gotcha. So it was your favorite part was going to get something that was part of your favorite color and showing everyone.
Yes, and I already had them.
Oh, cool. Well, we did the story of Noah this morning, didn't we?
Yes.
And what is the part of the story that you remember most?
You remember?
The monkey sliding down trees.
Yes, the monkey sliding down the trees. Was that pretty funny?
Yes. The monkeys also had a saw that they were cutting down trees, I said.
Cutting down trees.
Yeah.
They had to make the ark. Well, what else do you remember?
Noah built the ark.
And do you remember what happens the first time the dove went out?
It didn't find any land.
It didn't find any land. And then what happened the second time the dove went out?
It found land, I think.
Yeah, it found an olive branch, right? Which means that the water was coming down enough so that the dove could get a branch off of a tree. And then what happened the third time the dove went out?
It didn't come back.
It didn't come back because it found a new home, which meant that the water had gone away. I am always amazed in this part of the story about the dove, because the dove was really persistent, wasn't she? Meaning she kept at it. And if it were me, I might have gone out just one time. Yeah, like your helicopter. I might have just gone out one time. And then when I didn't find any land, I would have said, oh, well. But the dove kept at it. The dove kept at it. And that's a reminder to me to keep being persistent, to keep trying things, that just because it doesn't work the first or the second time doesn't mean that you don't keep trying. I also like the promise of the rainbow. Do you like rainbows?
Yes.
Yeah, what do you think is cool about a rainbow?
Colors.
Yeah. I think the colors are kind of neat, and how sometimes you can see all of them, and sometimes you can just see maybe a few things, a few colors. And sometimes you can see a whole rainbow, and sometimes you can only see a little bit.
Once I saw a rainbow, but it wasn't really bright.
It wasn't really bright. It just kind of was there in the sky.
It kind of faded.
Yeah. Yeah, they kind of do that. Once the moisture in the sky wears off and the sun comes out, they disappear. Yeah, I like rainbows too. And in our story, do you remember what a rainbow is a promise of?
Remember?
I forget.
No more floods.
No more floods.
Right. No more floods that cover the earth the way that flood did. And the promise is that God is with us always. So thanks for showing me your helicopter. It's really cool. It's green and white, isn't it?
I have tons of them. Here's a truck.
Oh, yeah, your truck and all kinds of stuff.
It's mostly white, but the little details are green.
Huh?
Okay. Like a helicopter, the pad on it. Oh. There's a helicopter pad on it, trailer for it.
Well, thank you for showing me your truck and your helicopter and your other truck and all. And as you said, you have tons of them. I see that. Oh. Look at that, it lights up, doesn't it? Wow.
It also the power spins, but the lights and there's a button, or you can just, there's a switch. Oh. Then you can just, if you don't wanna push the button, there's a switch to it. Lights just means you have to push the button.
Well. That's really neat. Hey, when we get back together in person again, you can show me that, okay? You can show me everything about it, how it works. Does that sound good? All right. Is there anyone that we should pray for today?
My sister that's back in college.
Uh-huh, we can pray for her. Anyone else?
Anyone else?
Pets.
The dogs, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, dog flying.
Okay, let's pray. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
For rainbows.
Rainbows.
Thank you for our pets.
Thank you for our pets.
And we pray for Anna.
And we pray for Anna.
That she would be safe.
That she would be safe.
And have a good time in college.
And have a good time at college.
Thanks for faith formation this morning.
Thanks for faith formation this morning.
And be with me this week.
Be with me this week.
Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Owen. We'll see you again soon, okay?
Bye.
Bye. We have our first lesson this morning, which comes from the book of Jonah.
Our first lesson is from the third chapter of Jonah. When God saw what the city of Nineveh did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come over Jonah to give him shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, "Is it better for me to die than to live?" But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, the great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from the left, and also many animals?" Here ends the first reading.
Thank you. And now, John, with our psalm.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Reading from Psalm 125, verses 1 through 8. "I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate. The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed, and I will declare your greatness. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love."
Thank you, John. And now our New Testament reading is from Philippians. Amy.
Second reading is from 1 Philippians, verses 21 to 30. "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel, and not frightened in anything by your opponents. This is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation, and that from God. For it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. Engaged in the same conflict that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. Here ends the lesson.
If you would like to follow along, our gospel lesson today is Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 to 16. Matthew chapter 20, 1 to 16. The Holy Gospel, according to Matthew, the 20th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out again and found others standing around. And he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When they was hired, about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now, when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowners, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Here in Moton, Pennsylvania, right outside of Reading, we can definitely tell that fall is in the air. The temperature drops dramatically in the morning, and we have the beginning of the 30-degree temperature shifts, which happened here in Pennsylvania in the fall and the spring. And I hope this finds you well, and I'm thankful that you are worshiping with us this morning. My sister, Rochelle, is a math teacher. And not only a math teacher, but
not too long ago, she actually went back to graduate school to learn how to teach math teachers how to teach math. Do you get that part? She went to school so that she could be a teacher of the math teachers. And it's absolutely fascinating to me because I am one of these people who did well in school, even in math, until it came time for things like geometry, trigonometry, and calculus. Theoretically, I understood that you had to find the area under the curve, but I didn't quite get the practical application. Perhaps you have had this experience sitting in a van at soccer practice or at a kitchen table or somewhere else when your child comes to you for help and wants to know how in the world 3 times 2 is 6, or 7 times 7 is 49, or how is it that all of the degrees of a triangle equal 180? And you fumble your way through an answer, unless perchance you're like Adam Miltelsky or the Brown family who actually have math teachers. Or maybe you've had this experience where your child or your grandchild is doing their homework and they have the right answer and they don't show it. And you ask them, how in the world did you get there? And they look at you as if you have 15 heads. Because, well, they can't really tell you how they got from point A to point B. But they got the answer right. And they're incredibly exasperated because they themselves don't even know their process. All they know is that to them, of course, X plus Y equals 5. And that doesn't even begin to explain the new math. The idea that numbers aren't always on a base 10, that sometimes they are on base 3 or base 7, or that one of the ways that you can explain the number 226 is 2 100s, 2 10s, and 6 1s. Math can be confusing and complicated. Whether it's the new math, old math, or math that hasn't even been invented yet. Then you have math with imaginary numbers, Greek letters, negatives, square roots, and all kinds of things. And as Mitchell just said, statistics. But what in the world does all of this calculation have to do with Jesus? How are you going to work that in today, preacher? Well, here's the thing. Today, we come face to face with God's economy, and it doesn't add up. It doesn't add up because at the end of the day, when the ones who had been in the vineyard since the beginning of the day and by their own justification had borne the heat of the day and had worked all day, when they saw that those who had worked only an hour received the full daily wage, they thought to themselves, well, if they got 100%, then we certainly get at least more, at least 100%, if not more than that. Maybe even 300%. So you can imagine their frustration. When it came time for them to receive their wage, they also received, in their mind, only 100%. And they started grumbling. They weren't grumbling over problem sets or repeats or the amount of time they have inputted functions into their calculators. No, they were grumbling over God's supposed unfairness. In other words, they were being incredibly human. And the landowner reminds them, "Are you angry at me because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." And therein begins the confusion. Because no amount of changing from base 3 to base 7 back to base 10 or using negative numbers or even Greek letters makes that math work. It's absolutely impossible unless you are in the kingdom of God. Because remember, the very beginning of the parable is, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner." And God's new math is all over the place. It is littered throughout Scripture. The smallest of a mustard seed becomes the largest bush. Miraculous things happen with a handful of fish and loaves of bread. Later on, the church will make an even more impossible math problem when they say that Jesus is 100% human and 100% divine. 100 plus 100 equals 100. So instead of scratching our heads and going to our nearest math teacher, perhaps instead, it might be worth our while to pause and give thanks. Give thanks because in God's economy, there is room for everyone. There is room for everyone. The wealthy, the powerful, the landowner, the vineyard steward, the day laborer who was hired at dawn, and the person who came at 5 p.m. There is room for those who grumble and room for those who rejoice. There's room for those who are generous and room for those who are stingy. There is room. And before we start pointing fingers at the other, we take a good hard look at ourselves and admit that all too often we have been the grumblers. We who have been given so very much. We who in Pennsylvania at the moment may be struggling with some job loss, some social isolation, some real economic difficulties. But what about our neighbors in the Southeast who are dealing with 2 feet of flooding because of a hurricane? What about our brothers and sisters on the West Coast who are dealing with millions upon millions of acres that have been burned and some of the worst air quality right now in the entire world? how about our friends that have to make the decision every day as to whether or not they go into work to provide for their families or stay home? What about those of you who are wrestling with how to do virtual school, a hybrid model, or in person, while figuring out childcare as well? What about those of you who are teachers who are struggling with this each and every day? Who love your students more than anything and who want them to learn, who want them to socialize, who want them to grow into good and responsible citizens, and yet you wonder if you're effective. Rest assured, there is place for lament, and I lament with you. Today, though, in the new economy of God, there is room for everyone. And that is good and great news, because it means that God's grace extends far further and far deeper, far wider and far taller than we could ever imagine or earn or deserve. No matter how many problem sets or homework sheets that we do. So today and this week, pay attention. Pay attention to the times when you grumble, when we all grumble. Acknowledge it. Say, yep, there it is. And thank goodness we have a God who is gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, whose love goes beyond any number of playground infinities. For God's new math, for the gift of those who teach us, for the strength of being community in a new way, to bear one another's burdens, for the promise of God with us all, we say together, thanks be to God.
Announcements this morning. Our God's Work Our Hands Sunday last week was fantastic. There was more than 2 carloads worth of things to distribute to both the food ministry and Family Promise. We will have upcoming pictures to show in our newsletter, and the response was, again, amazing. If Candy is on the call, perhaps she could unmute herself and tell what it was like when she dropped things off at Family Promise. Candy, are you there? Well, I see her. She is 610 777 775 487. So once we unmute you,
see exactly who you are. We should unmute them.
Okay. There you are.
Okay. Hello.
Hi.
Hi. Sorry. It was really great at Family Promise. They were so very, very thankful. They couldn't thank us enough. And our biggest thanks was to George Brown for getting us there, Miss Mary and I. And we carried in lots and lots of groceries, and they just thanked us for each and every one of those bags.
Thank you.
So thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Candy.
You're welcome.
Other announcements this morning include our upcoming crop walk, which we're going to show a video about, the spaghetti dinner, and the Welka sandwich sale. Amy, would you like to speak to the spaghetti dinner, please?
Sure. Our upcoming youth car side spaghetti dinner will be Saturday, October 17th from noon to 2. If you've already purchased tickets from when we were previously going to have the dinner back in March, your tickets will definitely be honored. And if you've misplaced them, just let us know and we'll work it out with you. Payment for anybody who's interested in purchasing dinners, just come on by and we'll settle up with you once you arrive. Pull into the Parish House Seakeeper side of the parking lot and you'll see some youth outside and we will bring you your dinner car side. And all of the benefits will go to our youth that are planning to attend the 2022 youth gathering in Minneapolis.
Thank you, Amy.
Sure. Oh, and the cost is $8 for adults and $5 for children 12 and under.
I will be on vacation after worship today through next week. And if you are in need of immediate pastoral care, the pastor to call is Pastor Colleen Cox of Grace Lutheran in Shillington. We do have another announcement today of Thanksgiving. We pray for Nicholas Gersha, Mary Knuckles' son and John's stepson, and his fiance, Lindsay Vallecco, who will be married this afternoon. So we're thankful for them. And thank you all for your financial response last week. We have made great progress in closing the gap between our income and our expenses. So thank you very much for that. And now we will show a video for the crop walk.
Thank you.
For those of you who are calling in or couldn't see the video, it was a way of saying that since the 38 years that we've done crop, we have raised over $1 million. Just our Redding Berks County Crop Walk has raised over $1 million. And there were some pictures from last year's crop walk, as well as an encouragement for us to participate this year. So get excited about it and see Amy Moltowski with questions. Are there any other announcements this morning?
I have one, Pastor.
Okay.
To the congregation, on Thursday night, the Western Berks Mission District had their annual assembly, and our Pastor Dietz was elected Dean of the Western Berks Mission District for the coming year. So congratulations to you, Pastor Dietz.
Oh, thank you. There are 43 congregations in our mission district, and while I am excited to be able to serve in that way, I never said, you know, I'd really love to go to more meetings. These are interesting times for sure. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need, responding to each petition with the words, "Graciously hear our prayer." So I will say, O God, you are full of compassion, and the response is, "Graciously hear our prayer." O God, you make the last first and the first last. Give resources and courage to the churches around the globe that have few resources. When ministry in this time is so difficult, inspire bishops, pastors, deacons, and congregational leaders in their service. O God, you are full of compassion. Graciously hear our prayer. To the places of conflict and violence, bring peace, especially to the cities of our nation. Bless the works of negotiators, peacekeepers, and development workers. Enlighten our nation, the nations we call friends, and the nations that are deemed our enemies. Keep our election season from dishonesty. O God, you are full of compassion. Graciously hear our prayer. Give your blessing to the Jewish people at this time of their new year. Bring an end to anti-Semitism around the globe and strengthen peace efforts in the Middle East. O God, you are full of compassion. Graciously hear our prayer. To those who are suffering, show your mercy. We pray for firefighters, for communities devastated by fires, for all who suffer injustice, for migrants who seek safety, for all who are imprisoned, for those who serve as police officers, for the unemployed, for students and faculty during the pandemic, for medical workers, for all who are hungry. O God, the list of the needy is so long. O God, you are full of compassion. Graciously hear our prayer. Give health and wholeness to all who are sick, to all who are suffering from the coronavirus, and to those we name before you now, either out loud or in our hearts. For the families of Tom, Hilda, and Marlene. O God, you are full of compassion. Graciously hear our prayer. give delight and wonder to Nicholas and Lindsay as they are married this afternoon. Strengthen all marriages. May spouses continue to find delight in one another as they live each day in fidelity. Continue to give them joy and strength through the difficult times. O God, who are full of compassion, graciously hear our prayer. You show mercy beyond our expectations, far beyond our deserving. Hear now our personal prayers. O God, you are full of compassion. Graciously hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is On Our Way Rejoicing. It is hymn number 537 in our cranberry hymnal, and in our green hymnal, it's hymn 260. Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. For those of you who would like